Huawei P20 Pro, a total of 92 megapixels, triple rear cameras, AMOLED with a notch, an ultra premium shiny design. This is one of the most interesting phones we've covered here on C4 Retech, so I can't really wait to talk about this one. Let's just jump right into it. If this is your first time here, or in case you just can't remember, my name's Ash, you're watching C4 Retech. Here's a card to our latest giveaway. I'll also be leaving a link to it in the description below. And while you're down there, please click that bell icon to make sure you don't miss out on any of our daily content. Let's now get started. So first, that shiny build. The P20 Pro looks great. It's got a glass back with a mirror-like finish. The metal frame feels nice in hand. The 7.8mm thickness and the 180g weight, the excellent screen-to-body ratio, they all ensure that it's not too difficult to wield. Huawei's done an excellent job. Hell, they've even thrown in an IR blaster to go along with that IP67 water and dust resistance. That's not to say the build is perfect. There are some cons. For starters, the back is slippery and picks up a ton of fingerprints. There is no headphone jack or microSD support. And given the glass back and the huge price tag, if you expected wireless charging, prepare to be disappointed. Anyway, I think I'm getting a little off topic. Let's stick to build and looks and say that Huawei has done a great job here. If you think this looks great, wait till you see the Twilight variant. That looks absolutely fantastic. Surely a head turner. Now, to the front, we've got a gorgeous AMOLED panel. This is a 6.1-inch display with a super weird 18.7:9 aspect ratio. The resolution is Full HD+, so you're looking at about 400 pixels per inch. The display gets quite bright, offers excellent viewing angles, and reproduces colors that look quite natural. Sharpness might be an issue if you do a lot of VR, but that's more of a niche case scenario. And for everything else, this display is excellent, especially for media consumption. The stereo speaker setup is one of the best I've come across in recent times. It's very loud and clear. Now remember that excellent screen-to-body ratio I talked about? Well, Huawei went the notch route to make that possible. But at least unlike other brands, they utilize the chin at the bottom with the front-facing fingerprint scanner. This fingerprint scanner is quite fast and very accurate. Talking about security, we live in a post-iPhone 10 world, so of course there's support for face unlock too. So, it looks great, has an excellent display, what's next? The internals, of course. The P20 Pro is powered by Huawei's own HiSilicon Kirin 970 chip. If that sounded vaguely familiar to you, that's because you've seen it already. We've covered it in the Honor View 10. We did review it a while back. The 970 is an excellent chip. In our time with it, we found it much better than its Qualcomm counterpart. But therein lies the problem. When the View 10 came out late last year, the Qualcomm counterpart was the Snapdragon 835, which the Kirin 970 bested with no issues. But now there's a new Snapdragon in town, and the 845 is much higher on the pecking order. This means Huawei has basically got last year's chip in here. Not that you're going to be noticing it with day-to-day usage or even with intense usage, the phone's blazing fast, the 6GB of RAM, 128GB of storage, everything's very fast and snappy, the P20 Pro runs on Emotion UI or MUI 8.1 built on top of Android 8.1 Oreo, the software is optimized to get the best out of this phone. That said, it might not be for everyone. It's got its own sets of pros, it's also got its own sets of quirks. Now, Huawei has been listening to user feedback. Some people have, you know, hated the notch, so there you go, a way to hide the notch, make it functional, but it still retains the kind of symmetry. A long time ago, MUI came with no app draw, back when it was called just Emotion UI. People didn't really like it, and Huawei added an option to get an app draw. But here's the but. To access the app draw, you need to tap the icon instead of swipe. It's a minor quirk, the fact that it takes an icon on your dock. It's easily fixed with switching to something like Nova Launcher, but it is a quirk nonetheless. Now the next one, it's not quite as easily fixable. Now, you know how all brands have been using some form of off-screen gestures these days. Huawei does too. You can turn off the navigation bar and control everything with a virtual home key or, wait for it, the fingerprint scanner. Makes sense, right? It's right there below the display, but when controlled with the fingerprint scanner, quick switch doesn't work. It does with the virtual key, but not with the fingerprint scanner. Again, not a major issue, but an issue nonetheless. When talking about things I disliked with the experience, It's just minor things like this. I feel I'm talking more about it because everything else is quite tastefully done. There are a lot of options for customization, and despite being feature rich, MIUI is one of the fastest interfaces out there. While there is some room for improvement, Huawei has done really well here. Another area where the P20 Pro shines is with regards to battery life. The P20 Pro sports one of the highest capacity batteries on a flagship phone today, 4000 mAh. That coupled with MIUI's optimizations mean excellent battery life. With my usual kind of usage, I ended almost every day with over 40% in the tank. The included supercharger could also charge this 4000 mAh battery from 0 to 100 in 90 minutes flat, which is again a great thing. Like I said earlier, I do wish Huawei had included support for wireless charging. One area where Huawei's gone all out though is with those cameras. We've got not one, not two, but three cameras to the back. The primary RGB camera, that's the one you see at the center. That's a 40 megapixel sensor with an f1.8 aperture. At 1x1.7 inches, the sensor is bigger in size than the sensors found on both the S9 Plus and the iPhone X. Now the one above it is an 8 megapixel sensor with a telephoto lens for 3x optical zoom, and the one below is a 20 megapixel monochrome sensor with an f1.6 aperture lens. This combined setup of Leica optics allows the P20 Pro to pull off some seriously impressive images. As far as focusing goes, the P20 Pro features a combination of depth detection from multiple cameras, contrast and phase detection, and a laser assist. As you can see, under good light, the performance is great. Lots of detail, great dynamic range. Note that I'm shooting in the 10 megapixel mode, though it's a 40 megapixel sensor. For various reasons, it produces the best results at 10 megapixels. If you want to know more, I'll leave a link to an article from GSM Arena in the description below that explains the workings in detail. Now, the Master AI option helps in automatically detecting a scene and tweaking settings to get the best out of this camera. It's a little too aggressive at times. Like every time it detects the sky, it boosts the blue. If it detects the trees and plants, boosts the green. A little too strong. That said, the images do pop, and there is a certain audience for pics like this. But with Master AI off and HDR on, yep, HDR is a dedicated mode here. One more sign of how Huawei's UI needs some tweaking. Now with HDR on, you get amazing shots like these. Just look at the clouds. I personally prefer shots like this over boosted colors in shots like this. Now, one of the cameras helps with detail, and that's the monochrome sensor. The lack of a Bayer filter on it lets it capture a lot more detail. Having multiple cameras also means you get portrait mode shots, apart from the wide aperture shots that Huawei's always provided. Now, Huawei lets you get two different portrait shots, one with the regular lens, one with the zoomed in lens. This means you don't need to get too close to your subject to shoot. Talking about zoom, you get 3x optical zoom, which as you can see is quite awesome. The colors via both sensors have been matched. Now that's always been a pet peeve of mine, to see colors not matched with phones that have dual cameras. Now even with this hybrid zoom, just see this. Here's where I'm standing. 3x zoom, 5x hybrid zoom, cropping in. The car's number plate is visible. To reiterate, we got a car's number plate shooting from here. Under low light, the camera gets even better. You know, regularly when I say low light, we go into how the performance takes a dip. But no, here it uses AI to be able to shoot for multiple seconds. The resulting images have very low noise levels. They look beautiful. It manages to outperform just about anything. Here's a side-by-side with the Pixel 2. Now with the Galaxy S9 Plus. So overall, excellent, excellent still images. But that said, as much as I love still images on this guy, I couldn't help but feeling let down by the videos. First, they're capped to 4K at 30fps while everyone's offering 4K 60. Secondly, there's no electronic stabilization for these 4K 30fps or even 1080p at 60. You get stabilization for 1080p videos shot at 30fps, but you don't expect to be happily shooting 1080p 30 on a phone you pay so much for, right? Moving on, there is support for 960fps at 720p. It comes with similar restrictions as with other brands. It's not great, but it's okay. It's there for what it's worth. As far as selfies go, the 24 megapixel selfie camera does a decent job. It's got a front portrait mode, which is quite nice. Not Pixel 2 levels, but definitely close to what Samsung and Apple have to offer. Now with all that, let's get to price. The P20 Pro retails for 65,000 rupees. This makes the P20 Pro the most expensive phone with last year's chip inside. Yes, the P20 Pro has a lot going for it. The oh my god still image quality, the amazing build with IP67 nonetheless, the excellent stereo speakers, loads of storage. But the limitations of the chip mean that you don't get some 2018 features like EIS at 4K or 4K 60fps. The video shooting experience leaves a lot to be desired. So basically, if you're okay with an older SoC, Pixel will offer better video stabilization and selfies. You will compromise on still images, yes, but you do get a phone that's much cheaper. If you're willing to pay 60K plus, then the iPhone X and S9 Plus both come into play. They both offer better videos, comparable or better builds, much faster chips inside. And again, you do lose a bit on images. If cameras aren't all that important to you, Huawei's own sub-brand Honor gets you the same chip at about half the price. All this together means unless still images are of the highest priority, you can pass on this one. This was a really hard conclusion for me to write because I really like the P20 Pro. Huawei's done a great job with it. But as much as I love it, absolutely adore those cameras, very happy with those stereo speakers, I really can't find myself recommending it for 65,000 while these other options exist. So there you go, my two cents. Do you agree with my conclusion? Do you disagree? Let me know in the comments below. And now, I must bid you adieu. If you hated the video, you know what to do. But if you did like it, go ahead, give it a thumbs up, share, subscribe, and hit that bell icon to turn on notifications. If you do want to pick a Huawei P20 Pro, I'll leave direct links in the description. Use them, helps the channel out. Thanks a lot for watching. Till next time, my name's Ash. You've been watching C4 eTech, and I'm signing off. You guys have a great day. Bye-bye.